Hello and welcome to my latest gun video. Now today I'm not going to actually show you any guns for a change, or fix any or anything like that, but what I thought I'd do is do a technical kind of general discussion video and about misfiring of firearms. Now misfiring is when you have a cartridge in the chamber and you go to fire the gun and it doesn't fire for whatever reason. And that's what we're going to talk about today, the various reasons why. It's a common problem, and I just thought of doing this video because I've got a couple of firearms on the go now that I'm trying to fix. And over the last little while, I've fixed a few that have been misfiring. And over the years, it's a reasonably common problem. In fact, I think as far as firearms faults go, it's probably one of the most common problems. So what I thought I'd do is just do a video just about the causes of misfiring in firearms, and how to go about trying to find the cause in order to be able to fix it. What I want to do today is say, okay, you've got a rifle that's misfiring, or a fire, not just a rifle, any firearm, rifle, pistol, shotgun, that's misfiring. What can be the cause? Obviously, if you're going to fix it, you have to know what's causing it. So I'm just going to look at the causes of misfires, and then just briefly mention, I'm not going to go into any detail, but I'll briefly mention how you fix those, and some are easier than others. All right, so the first and most obvious one, I think, is ammo. First thing you've got to look at, you're having misfires. You know, you get a gun out. I mean, it might be a firearm that you've got no personal experience with, so you don't know whether it's been misfiring, you might have just bought it or whatever. Or it might be a firearm that you've got, that you've been using and it's been fine, and then suddenly it starts to misfire. So if it's just started, obviously the first thing you do is look at your ammo. Is it different ammo to what you used to use or whatever? So there's a variety of reasons why ammo might misfire. One is if it's just crap. I've come across ammo over the years that just has a large, not a large percentage, but just has regular misfires, especially in 22 rimfire ammo. If you just get cheap crap, you'll often get that. And especially it's a function of the firearm as well. If the firearm has a fairly light strike anyway, with high quality ammo it might be fine and you'll never get a misfire. But as soon as you start put some cheaper stuff in, you might get the odd one. So if you're getting misfires with a particular type of ammo, well then maybe try something different. In rimfires it might be trying different brands of rimfire. Some has harder cases than others, so if you've got a rifle that's providing pretty light strikes, then try another one that may be softer. Incendiary fire ammo can be to do with the primer as well. Some primers, Federal primers for example, are much softer generally than the other ones. CCI, in my experience, I think are the harder ones. So say you're reloading incendiary fire ammo and you're getting misfires with CCI, well, before you start looking at the firearm too much, it might be worth just next time you load, get some Federal primers and you might find that will solve the problem. And the other thing is just old ammo. Like I've had some really old military ammo that I've shot over the years, and you'll get the odd misfire with that just from pure age and probably chemical breakdown of the propellant and priming. The way the ammo is stored as well. If ammo has been stored in, and especially if it's old and it's been stored in maybe damp or hot conditions. You've got to look at your ammo storage to make sure it's stored in good conditions. So that's a pretty obvious one, and that's pretty easy. You just got to muck around and see if it is an ammo issue, and as long as you get back onto some decent ammo, you should be able to solve that one. So, number two. I need to get myself some new whiteboard markers. Number two, which one will we do as number two? Probably sort of maintenance, I guess. Especially in striker fire rifles, mainly. Just lack of lubrication, dirt, etc., can actually result in misfire. So, say you've got, you know, a bolt, there's rimfire or centerfire, you've got a bolt action bolt. There's the bolt. We do an X-ray in thing. You've got a hole through the center of it. Firing pin there. Spring around it, something like that, and then it's some sort of sear system. Let's do a sear at the back. We've got a sear. Sear. With your trigger. Something like that. So you pull your trigger and it drops the sear and goes forward. Now, this space in here obviously needs to be clean and lubricated for that to be able to slide back and forth. Especially in rimfire bolts, because the actual whole thing is smaller and the actual mass of the firing pin is much smaller. If this gets full of, gets dirt in it, or gets dry and has lack of lubrication, has a high friction, and a very common thing is just general gun oil and preservative kind of oils. Over years, if it hasn't been pulled apart for 50 years, the oil, all the volatile parts of the oil evaporates away and it leaves this sticky, gummy residue, and that can be just like a glue. It almost slows down the firing pin as it's trying to slide forward. So, yeah, so the next thing to do, once you've checked your ammo out, if you get a firearm that's misfiring, first thing to do is, regardless of what general mechanical mechanism it has, pull it apart, give it a good degrease, clean, get all the dirt out of it, look for any obvious broken bits that are, you know, any reason that might be slowing the striker or the hammer or whatever down, and give it a good oil and put it back together, give it another try. And in a lot of older firearms, that can solve your problem. So we'll go straight on from there to the next thing, is three, and that's the spring. Now, I'll go back to that Ruger Model 77 I was talking about. I had it for quite a number of years, used to shoot it, never misfired at all. And then I was actually out goat shooting once, and, you know, lined up a goat, and it just went click. My first thought at the time was, being a reloader, as reloaded ammo, oh crap, I haven't put bloody powder in that case. But I extracted the case and the bullet was still there, and you still get powder in it, and it had a soft stripe. And I think it fired on the second go, but it's like, well, that was a bit strange. And then as I fire that rifle more often, I started getting misfires more often, still sporadic, but in the end I'd go to the range and possibly every 10 or 15 shots I'd get a misfire. I could usually lift the bolt, put it down, and it would fire the second time. But there was something weird going on with that. Now I went through this whole program maintenance that I just talked about. I pulled it apart, cleaned the bolt, oiled it, put it back together again. It really didn't make any difference. I couldn't see any obvious reason. The rifle had probably only fired, you know, maybe 1,000 rounds or something like that from you. So we're going to talk about headspace later on, but you wouldn't expect a headspace problem. So it sort of seemed to come back to a problem with the spring, even though it looked fine. And of course, they have a captive spring. You know, it's all kind of together in the you can unscrew the back off the bolt, but the spring's actually held. So in the end, what I did with that one is I saw in the Brown Hills catalogue that you could get a Wolf. There's a company in America, Wolf Springs, who make spring specialists, who make springs mainly for guns, I think. It's supposed to be very high quality. They tend to make repair kits for various things. They actually had in Model 77 extra power mainspring listed. So so I bought one of those, ordered one of those from the States, and also the tool to disassemble the bolt. Pulled it apart, it took 5 minutes, pulled it apart, put the new spring in, put it back together again. And that rifle has never misfired since. The original spring looked fine, it didn't look damaged, it looked stretched. Obviously it had lost, there was some sort of metallurgical reason why it had lost its power and it was just causing light strikes. That was, you know, one case where, you know, it was just purely a spring problem. Now, in that case, I was actually able to buy a new spring that was actually designed for that rifle by the spring manufacturer. That's sort of a bit unusual, unless it's a common rifle like that, or a common firearm like that. Usually you're going to have to go to a spring place or whatever and find a suitable spring. Now, so I'll just have a quick word about replacing a spring. So, say you've got a firearm, it's misfiring, you've done everything else, you can't work out why it's misfiring, you think, well, maybe I should replace the mainspring just to see if that, you know, helps. And that's not an unreasonable thing to do. So what you do is you pull it apart and get the spring. They're almost always, there's two types of spring, there's compression and tension spring. Tension springs are the ones with the little loops on the end that you see, but you don't tend to see them in guns. Almost all springs in guns are compression springs. So you basically just got the spring like that. Now, when you pull it out, there's sometimes a few giveaways that a spring is worn out. Very commonly in spring powered air guns. I reconditioned a couple of air guns a couple of years ago, working on BSA Meteor. And I just recently did a Webley, which I'm about to put that up on YouTube. But often you'll pull the spring out, and instead of being nice and straight like that, it'll tend to be, that's a bit exaggerated, but you know, it's all kind of bent. So obviously there's, you know, you haven't got an even push when it's got all these bends in it. So that can be a giveaway that the spring's a bit worn out. The other thing is often it'll be, if you get a new spring, it'll end up being longer than the original one, because the original one's had a set, which means it's been, when it's pushed in, it hasn't boiled back out again to its full length, it's actually stayed pushing. You'll see that in like in cars, for example, in old cars, you know, they sit down lower because the springs have just lost their set and they don't need to replace it. So now you pull the spring out, so what you got to do is, the first thing you measure is this external diameter. From there, let's get this. Measure that distance there. The next thing to do is measure the actual wire, accurately measure the wire diameter. And that one, for example, was a 0.04. Measure the length, but more important than that, it's actually the number of loops. So coils, so say this one could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So 7 coils. So you can then look on, if you can't find a spring anywhere, you can look on spring manufacturers' websites, and they'll often have charts of external diameter, wire size. They'll have a lot of other stuff. There's the actual pressure and all that sort of stuff. It's the engineering kind of thing, which is not really relevant to us. You know, you just kind of go through these things. But go through those, get the approximate length, because they don't tend to say the number of coils, but they'll say the length. So say this was, 4 inches, for example. Just remember that a new spring may be longer than that because it's got a bit of set. So you might see one that's listed as, you know, 0.3, 0.33, and 0.04. They'll often be, if they're imperial, often be pretty much the same. You can get one a little bit longer, And then just make sure we get it and count the number of coils. And you use the same number of coils as in the original spring. So, you know, length is 4, you might end up finding one that's 5 inches long that actually ends up having 9 coils. So you might have to cut off a coil off each end to get it to the right number of coils and then replace it. One thing is, I think modern springs, the metallurgy of springs was not nearly as good 100 years ago as it is now. So you might get this exactly the same spring, but it's made out of modern chromium, molybdenum, whatever wire, which will just have a lot more springiness, you know, to use a non-engineering term, than an original spring that was made exactly the same 100 years ago. So in some cases, just replacing the spring will give, even if the other spring looks all right, will give more force to the firing mechanism and will solve your misfiring problem. So, there's springs, anyway, but if, you know, if you still can't find anything, another one to look at is the firing pin. Now, you probably, you know, when you went up and did this bit up here and pulled it apart, had a bit of a look, your maintenance of your mechanism, you would have had a look at the firing pin. So any really obvious things would become obvious. But there's a few different things that can happen with firing pins that can actually lead to misfiring. So, and I've seen all of these in my limited gunsmithing experience. I've fixed up all of these. So they're not uncommon problems. So we'll just talk about them one by one. So the first and obvious one is broken firing pin. Now, in some guns, you'll be shooting, the firing pin will break, and it'll be obvious, like the next shot is just click, won't work, don't work out why, or you look at where the firing pin comes out and it's missing because it's kind of fallen out on the ground or whatever. But just because it's broken doesn't necessarily mean it's not going to work. Now, for example, I recently fixed up my Spanish side lock 12 gauge side by side shotgun that I've had for about 15 years now. I've been shooting it regularly for all those years, and then about probably 4 years ago, I take it out to play target shoots, and it would just occasionally misfire. You know, in a field of 25 plays, I might get 2 misfires. And I just didn't think too much of it. I think I went through this year. Initially, I kind of opened it up and made sure it was side lock. And I don't think I put all the locks for quite a number of years. I put the locks out of the room and did all that. Put it back in. Still misfiring. There was no obvious reason why. But then it got worse and worse. And then, to the extent I went out and shot some plays, and I got about 5 or 6 misfires over it, and it was in the right barrel, so it was the first shot, over 25 plays, of course 25 plays, and something, something's going on with this gun, and whatever it is getting worse. So I had a really good look at it, and I could see the firing pins in their holes, and they looked alright, but then, then I realised that I had to look at it closely, and I never really looked at one of those types of firing pins that had broken before, but it became obvious. So if this is this stupid pins. Yeah, I just found this one, it's called a flip chart marker. Now, is that like a whiteboard marker or is that a permanent? We'll have to see. That's right. All right. So we might go to that one. Was that green one's great? There was. That's right. I was drawing a. Okay. So we've got the standing breech of a shotgun. We've got a kind of hole where the firing pin comes out. The cartridge. Goes in the chamber like that. And so this tends to. They tend to have a hole in them like that. So that's what the hole looks like, and your firing pin protrudes at the back here, because remember, being a side lock, you've actually got an internal hammer hitting that. So that's in like that, and then you've got your like that. And these are floating foreign pins, they don't actually have a pin in them, so what they have is a little slot here with a side screw that just holds it, but the firing pin can float back and forth. Now, what I noticed was if I pushed, what I did was pull the lock off, push the pin forward so it protruded, so at this point we have no cartridge in there obviously. This is just at home, when I got home that night and I was trying to figure out what the hell was coming out of this gun. I pushed it out so that the pin protruded to lock out. But then I could actually grab the back of the firing pin and pull it back, and that came back, and I could still, the end of the pin didn't move. So it was obvious that the two ends of the firing pin weren't actually no longer on that one particular piece. Yet this firing pin didn't actually fall out. That's just what one thing would happen. They could just fall out and be lost. That's what happened in this combination gun at all. Before I bought it with a broken pin. So I knew that was broken. And it's like, okay, well, that's why. And the interesting part is when I actually took it out, I just had unscrewed the screw and then I pushed something through, pushed the two pieces out. The front, so we had the back of it, they always break here where the shoulder goes to the pin part. So we had the back part of the pin here, and we had the front part of the pin there like that, and because that pin had been sitting there, the back bit, and you had a cartridge, the back bit had been whacking into the back of it. It had actually pinned the back of the pin, of the firing pin fragment, put a shoulder on it so it actually couldn't fall out of the hole. So it was actually, and that's probably what had been happening for years and years. And then I think what had happened is this pin had got worse and worse, so that it no longer went through the hole properly, so the misfiring got worse. Interesting thing was though, when I pulled that out, I thought, well, I'll have a look at the other one while I'm there, and I took the other one out, the left-hand barrel, and that was also broken, and obviously had been for quite a while, but that one had never misfired, so it was still, even though it was in two pieces, it hadn't pinned enough, or maybe the dimensions of the hole were a little bit different, so it actually still worked. So they can be broken. So that's what you got to do. You've got to look at both ends of the pin and just make sure you're confident they're all in one piece. If it's easy, actually take the whole pin and we're going to make sure that it's all in one piece and looks okay. A striker. If you're British, you would call that a striker rather than a farm. So, but right here. Right, now, number two on the firing pin is free movement. So what that means is the firing pin is free to move back and forth from where it sits to when it's hit and all the way to hit the base of the cartridge. Now this kind of comes back a bit to maintenance. When we talked about maintenance, when you had gum or dirt or lack of lubrication or whatever, that impeded free movement and so caused misfires. But free movement can also be impeded by mechanical issues. So you might get peening, if the metal's soft and cheaper firing, you might get peening of the pin, so it's just not going back and forth, or peening the inside of the wherever it goes in the bolt or whatever, depending on the mechanical thing. So you just need to look at it. You know, sometimes you can have a look, and if it just doesn't seem to move freely where it should be, you might need to work out why. And in some cases, that involves getting a file and just judiciously filing some. So assuming that it's not broken, it's got free movement, next thing to do is look at the tip, sort of the shape of the tip. The tips can get broken off, they can get worn, they can get peened flat, which comes down to the next one as well. But just have a look at the tip and make sure. Sometimes, and have also, when you have a look at the tip, also have a look at the cartridge, have a look at the dent in the cartridge, whether it's a rimfire or a semifire. See where it is, So for example, you might have a rimfire cartridge that's just being dented, not being dented properly, because the firing pin is sort of, a bit knackered on the end, and you know, there's only hitting here and over here. So you might find that, you know, by judiciously taking a bit of this off, not too much though, because otherwise you're reducing the protrusion and concentrating the dent, you might get it so it actually dents a bit more effectively. That's just an example. So, and I'll get to the next bit. If you get your tip and fix it up, but then it's still not denting properly, you may have insufficient protrusion. So what firing pin protrusion is going back to our little shotgun breech. You push the pin all the way, so it's sticking out as far as it can, that distance there, this pin's not much good, is the firing pin protrusion. Now you can see charts that says it should be 0.0, whatever it is, 0.0025 or something. I don't really worry too much about that. What I do is look at the tip, look at the dent in the cartridge, where it is, how deep it is. Because you can always try it just with either, if you centre fire either with an empty cartridge with a primer in it, or just shoot 22 or pull the bullet out of a 22, try it. So what I do is just get it, have a look at the dent, see how deep it is. Have a look at the protrusion, if I'm making a new firing pin for a gun that's got a broken firing pin, I always make the protrusion more than I think it's going to need to be when I first make the pin, because you can make them shorter, but you can't make them longer. And then once you put it in here, you know, say you put it in here and stick it away like this, well then you can then, because it's also a function of where the pin sits in this little hole. So it's hard to know until you actually put it in. So you can put it in, tap it forward as much as possible, and then decide, okay, I want to get rid of all that. So then you can take it, you can file that off, file it back to shape, put it back in, and the protrusion just goes right. So I tend to just do protrusion, both by eye, just looking at it, and also by the dent in the cartridge. Now, if you get, what can happen is in, especially in cheaper firearms or very old ones with firing all the shots, is the end of the firing pin can just get worn and peen and just end up being not sticking out enough. So if that's the case, the only way to fix that, well, there's two ways. One is to make a new firing pin. And if it's a simple design like this, which is pretty easy to do, like these shotgun pins, you can knock one of them up in sort of 10 minutes, 15 minutes. But the other thing you could do is, because you've got this shoulder where it sits, as long as this back bit is sticking out enough for the gun to hit, you can sometimes just take a bit off the shoulder, either with putting it in the lathe and with a file, or even in a drill press or whatever, and just use it with file, and then keep putting it back in the gun and just take it a bit off so that it brings it forward. And as long as you've still got enough sticking out the back, increase your firing pin protrusion by that. But the next thing we'll talk about, and the last thing we'll talk about, is headspace. So if you're not familiar with headspace, I'll just very briefly try to explain what it is. So in a new rifle, let's just say it's a 22 rifle with a rim for ease. So you've got your chamber. You've got your 22 cartridge sitting in this chamber, and then the bolt closes and you've got the bolt there. Well, the bolt's never going to be hard up against the cartridge. There's always going to be a tiny space there, because you need to allow for tolerance, you need to allow for specks of dust, you need to allow for different temperatures in the metal expanding and contracting, you need to allow for cartridges to have to make up slightly different rim thicknesses, just different tolerances. So there's actually a specified tolerances for heads, well, that's what's called headspace. Now, if you get a firearm which has had a lot of wear, so maybe the locking system, like with a bolt, typically in 22 bolt actions where the bolt goes into a slot in the receiver, that can just get worn. So you might take a foul or something just wear off that over a 100-year period. what that ends up being is you have your chamber again. A lot of luck with my pen. There's your cartridge, but then your bolt face ends up being back here. There's actually a bigger space than there should be in there. So that's called excessive head space. Now what that means is when the, let's say it's a rimfire, when the firing pin comes forward here, either that space is so big that with our normal firing pin protrusion, it only just hardly doesn't really crush the primer effectively, or if when you start, if you've been say pointing up in the air and the cartridge is laying back against here, because there's some movement, when the firing pin hits it, the cartridge is sort of forced forward a little bit, that absorbs a lot of the pressure, a lot of the force of the firing pin strike, and so it doesn't crush the primer properly. Now this can happen in centerfires as well, in any fire. And in high power and high pressure centerfires, it's actually it's a safety issue. So if you suspect a high power rifle's got excessive head space, you shouldn't be shooting it until it's fixed up. With 22s, there's no real danger, but you can get light strikes and misfires. Now, if we look at, say you might say, oh, what can I do about this? There's not, say it's a 22 we're talking about. There's not a lot you can do about it as far as fixing the headspace. You can maybe, like in a bolt action, you might be able to pin the metal of the receiver or the bolt a little bit just to make it lock up a little bit tighter, bring this forward a little bit. If you can do something mechanical like that easily to improve the headspace. But the only other thing you can do in a 22 that's got excessive headspace is just to try to increase the firing pin protrusion a little bit so that it actually crushes the case a bit better. So that's about the end of that little talk. If you're still listening, I assume that you didn't get completely bored and switch off, which probably a lot of people did, but basically what I wanted to do was you know, just get some information out there. So if someone's got a rifle, maybe you've got an old 22 or something, it's misfiring, you don't know why, you don't really want to take it to a gunsmith because it'll cost you three times as much as it's worth, but you know, you'd like to fix it, well this just gives you an indication of the steps to go through, and really most firearms that are misfiring, if you go through these steps, probably 90% of them are going to be able to fix them and fix the problem. And but it may take more than one go, as I've found myself, you know, like if you think it's the mainspring, you can't find out, put a mainspring and it's still misfiring, you know. So then you go to, well, what else could it be? So anyway, follow these five steps, have a look at all of these, and you should be able to sort out why it's misfiring. So anyway, until next time, thanks for watching.